could go again. Hello everyone, Richard Shaw here for Licklibrary. So thank you for joining us tonight. I'm going to go over five things that I feel that are very, very, very important for guitar players that are actually relatively quick fixes. You can fix these things in usually about 1 minute. Even if you do 5 1-minute practices and keep repeating those kind of things, it's amazing how much better you'll improve in a very, very short amount of time when you're super, super focused. So I'm going to talk about those things today and answer any questions you have. Speaking of which, James, I actually can't see the comments on my end. So I don't know if there's any way to fix that. So aha! See, this is me and technology, everybody. So, there we go. So, hi, everybody. So, hi, Kate. Is that helmet strap? Hello, everybody. Tony B, thanks for joining. Everybody say hi, who's in? Rob Rich, hi. Reg Ham. Christopher, Alan, Marcus. Steely Danny backing track. Is it a Steely Dan backing track? I think it's just a regular Licklibrary thing, isn't it? I'm talking to the operator of all things, which is James, who's Licklibrary's video guy, who all the good stuff you see is James's work. He makes me look good, and he's sorting out all the technology as well. So I will answer as many questions as I can, but I'm also going to talk to you about five things that I find are very, very important that you can usually fix or at least work on in 1 minute for each of these things. I'm going to show you how to do that. And I still do this on a pretty much a daily basis as much as I can for each of these five things. So first of all, let's find out where people are from. So Robert Goldsmith, I'm from Las Vegas. So wow. So you're 8 hours behind us, I believe. So yeah, thanks for joining us. Brilliant, yeah. Where's everybody else? My brother is even on here. Morning, he says. Probably does feel like morning for you working your night shifts. So anyway, let's get stuck in. So the first thing I want to talk about is bending accuracy. And it's something I've noticed with a lot of my students and a lot of people at Licklibrary have been asking about how to practice bending accuracy. And you'll see most of these things that I talk about today is all about listening. So there are other ways around it, but most importantly, these are our most valuable tools as guitar players. We have two of these for a reason. We need to be able to listen and really focus on what we're playing to make sure it sounds good first and foremost. After all, music is an auditory form. So we need to make sure it sounds good, and then I have little tricks that help me from a visual point of view. So I'm going to take the good old A minor pentatonic scale. I'm going to take this 7th fret of the G string, but I want to bend it so it sounds like the 9th fret. So there's the 7, 9. Now I'm not a singer, but ba 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 ba, I'm trying to get ba 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 stuck in my head. And then with the bending, from a technical point of view, in order to reach that pitch, I'm basically using my 3rd finger, making sure, my favorite word, fulcrum. I have a fulcrum here and a fulcrum here, like just like almost like a pivot point that I'm either side of a neck. And I've got these two fingers helping me out to, I think of it as like you're trying to get over a wall. You can do it on your own, you can do it by yourself, but it's easier when you've got a couple of mates giving you like a leg up over the wall. So that's what these guys are doing. So that's what I'm doing. It's more using my ears to find that note. Ba, 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 trying to find that. But I'm also using my eyes, like visualizing the note. I'm almost picturing that this note here, to get to that pitch, needs to be at least where the D string is. So I'm kind of aiming for the string above, pushing that out of the way with the bit like next to my nail that I'm pressing down here, where the dint is in my fingers, but between that and the nail itself, I'm using that to push the other string out of the way. Kind of push it to where it is now. Like that, roughly where the D string is, where it's naturally resting. So then I do that, and then in the words of Guthrie Govan, I kind of just get used to how much that hurts as well. I kind of feel it. I want to feel the string. I want to get a good grip of it, and I need to know that I'm reaching that note. Even if I can't hear myself very well, I'm in the rough ballpark. I also do the same thing with one fret bends as well. But I also do it with pre-bends as well. That really tests me to make sure I've definitely got it absolutely bang on the money, because I'm not listening and settling when it's there. Just get used to the feel of it, and then hopefully my pre-bends are absolutely bang on. And I'll do that for however many frets, 3 frets, for example. And that's kind of how it works. And I'll try that with every single finger as well. So, and I suggest you do the same, because you never know which finger you're going to land on when you play a solo or any kind of musical excerpt. So yeah, so I hope that helps with bending accuracy. Try that all over the neck, try it with all the different fingers. Visualize it on the fretboard, but also really listen for the notes you're aiming for. The target note is very, very, very important. Cool. So other people, like, we've got any questions in particular? So we've got people from Memphis, South Africa, Liverpool, Leicestershire, Perth in Scotland, Abu Dhabi, wow, Sweden, everybody's all over the place, Hamburg. And Nick Jennison, the legend, Nick Jennison. How are you, mate? Hope you're doing well. Hope I'm doing well in my first live stream, because you are the king of these things, my friend. So, and Christopher's a Cradle of Filth fan. For those of you who don't know, I was in a band called Cradle of Filth. I did the last 3 albums with them and a live album. And yeah, so nice to hear from Cradle fans as well. Cool. So, the next thing I want to talk about is left hand muting, and I find this is a very quick fix when you get used to it. For me personally, this is my biggest bugbear with a lot of my students, and yes, it takes a lot of work, but usually like 1 minute a day is all I ask them to do, and it's amazing what happens within a week. Left hand muting, for those of you like unsure, is literally what it says on the tin. I'm muting the unwanted strings. So if I'm playing, for example, the 7th fret of the A string, grab your guitars and give this a go, I want to be able to mute the other 5 strings with any bit of kind of available flesh. So usually the underside of these fingers for any strings that are technically the thinner strings underneath what I'm physically playing here. And I can use my thumb, or again, like when I'm bending, like the side, the kind of top of my finger there to kind of mute it. So I'm trying to get the 7th fret of the A string only, and I should be able to only hear that one note, but beefed up by 5 muted notes. So. So it's that kind of thing. So I'm trying to do it with the 7th fret of the A string first, because I'm trying to make sure this low E is muted and everything underneath. It doesn't really matter what the rhythm is. You're just really trying to isolate any sound that shouldn't be there. Like if you've got a little, like I'm pressing down a little bit too hard here, so I need to release that a little bit, get a bit of the pressure off. And again, I'll try this with all 4 fingers. So there's the 1st finger. And again, I'll just move it ever so slightly. And then I'll try it on the low E string as well. And again, even if I am getting a little bit of like some harmonics or a note that shouldn't be there, I am just kind of slightly adjusting, like literally bit by bit, just kind of really using my ear and feeling where those notes are coming out and just adjust it ever so slightly. Gets a little bit trickier on the D string because now there's a low E string that's kind of left open. That's open season right now. That's when using more than one finger can be very, very useful. Like making sure I'm dampening behind this finger in particular, over there. And again, everything's covered underneath. Same with the G string. And like I say, you could do any rhythm you like, try it with all the fingers, try it in different areas of the neck, even try and do it between two different notes on a particular string. Like. And you try it that way, try and make up something with it. That's another thing I always try and do. Whatever I'm trying to practice, I don't just do it as an exercise, because to me that can be quite boring. So what I do is I try and make up a little something with it as well. It can be a riff, it can be a full song, it can just be literally two or three notes that I think sound cool, and it can grow from there into something bigger, something more creative. So I hope that helps with left hand muting. Let's go back to the comments. So, is it worth using a headstock tuner as well to practice bending to tune and seeing the note on the tuner? That's from John. John is actually one of my stateside students. And that's a great, great tip. You can use that. You can use any tuner. In fact, David Gilmore, when he's playing live, he actually has a tuner set up that's kind of muted, so he can physically see the tuning of what he's trying to pitch when he's doing the bend, which is almost like a fail safe. And if you're someone like David Gilmour, who does a lot of bends and is famous for it, you want to make sure those things are as accurate as possible. So that's a great tip, John. Yeah, cheers for that. That also helps as well. It's anything to help you visualize and also hear that note will definitely help. So if you have a headstock tuner or a floor mount tuner, rack mount tuner, whatever it may be, a tuner in whatever DAW you're using when you're recording, that will definitely, definitely help as well, a more visual clue. So Gareth, another one of my students. So always great to hear your guitar technique tips, always get something from them. Thank you, Gareth, appreciate that. And David Yates says, evening, Nick. Makes change seeing you this side of the comments. It does, it's great. I'm always checking out Nick's live streams and he has some fabulous, fabulous tips. I've learned a lot from Nick, even though I've been playing quite a long time now. It's always worth listening to what other people have to say. Even on things you think you know about, they can always explain it in a different way, in a clearer way, and just makes everything that little bit clearer and a different way of looking at things. So always learning, always listening. So thank you, Nick, for your live streams as well. So with the muting, what if the problem is the other way around, i.e. unwanted muting? So unwanted muting, that's a very good point. Basically what I do with unwanted muting is, again, I analyze it. I'm playing along and I'm going, okay, at which point am I muting a string I don't want to? For example, if I'm just playing a relatively basic chord, let's take a C. Hopefully everybody knows and loves a C chord. Okay, so for things like this, I'm making sure that my thumb, it probably doesn't look like it because my thumb does wrap around quite a bit, but especially when I first start to play, I made sure my thumb came down that little bit more. And what ends up happening, it's like the kind of angle things go like that. So there's the guitar note, for example. And you start to bring the thumb down. There's my thumb. I don't know how we can see that. There we go. If I bring this down, my fingers can wrap around a little bit more. I don't need to do it excessively so, but I can wrap it around a little bit more just so I don't get this. I don't want that. So I can wrap that around a little bit more, or I just actually place, I like replace the finger down and just kind of try to use a different part of my finger. Sometimes a little bit more of a side, just a little bit more on the tip if I need it. So I still approach the guitar like I'm learning the very, very basics. Everything I do, whether it's a new chord, a riff, a solo, whatever it is, I'm still checking that I can hear all the notes I want to hear and muting the notes I don't want to hear. So it's sometimes it's worth it and you feel like, oh, I'm kind of going backwards because I'm getting strings muted that I shouldn't be, but it's well worth it. It's well worth the effort. You'll be surprised how quickly that can turn around when you're really focused on trying to get that string to ring that should be. Like for instance, like going like this. Just making sure you're really, really wrapped around. Like my thumb is quite far down to make sure I can really hear those open B and B and E strings. My thumb was more round. Now I can feel it here. So I'm actively trying to listen and also feel where those muted strings happen. So I hope that helps. So, next thing I want to talk about is timing. Like how to actually improve your timing. So, and this is something that I get asked a lot, and there's the traditional thing of get a metronome, which I'm never going to say don't get a metronome. I'm not saying that at all. I love metronomes, but like most people, I started playing guitar when I was 11 and didn't play along to a metronome until I was 18. And it was a horrifically humbling experience. I thought I was pretty good because I was playing in bands and I thought my timing was pretty good. I mean, it didn't sound like we completely sucked, but when I came to play with a metronome and record in a studio, I was like, oh no, I really needed to work on to a click. So if you're new to a metronome, what I suggest is just going on YouTube or using Licklibrary, whatever you need to do, to get like some kind of backing track or just a drum beat and really, really focus in on where beats 1, 2, 3, and 4 are. So for example, I'll take a regular E chord for ease. So I haven't got a drum machine set up, but for example, I could go on YouTube or Licklibrary and find a drum pattern that's just going like 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. And I find the one thing that a lot of people forget to do is almost internalize it. What ends up happening is they're kind of hearing the music and let it kind of wash over them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. What I suggest to students is to physically move your body, whether that be tapping your foot, nodding your head. I mean, us metal guys like to headbang, you know, and it's not only does it look cool when the main's out, but it actually helps keep in time and you get into the groove a little bit more. So that's what I'm doing. I'm kind of really focusing, feeling that, like I'm tapping my foot right now, just feeling where that beat is. Like 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. But I'm actively making a point, like if there was a drum, like a snare drum, I'm actively like putting an emphasis on beats 2 and 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then I'll try that with the drum machine, the drum pattern, with the metronome, whatever it is, and I'm constantly doing that. So something like this, I'm gonna hit beats 2 and 4. So 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And so on and so on. I'll try it on beats 1 and 3. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Try it on beats 1, 2, 3, and 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And so on and so on, kind of dividing the beat. But little things like, and I know it sounds childish, but it definitely helped me. Especially playing in musical theatre, I tried to get into musical theatre and I actually shadowed a couple of guitar players who you may know. And I saw on their manuscript actually written out what the rhythm is, not just in terms of the notation, but above the notation, they were doing things like teas and coffees and Coca-Colas, strawberries, lemonades. I was like, what is that about? And I thought, if these West End guys are doing that, that obviously helps, and it not only helps their sight reading, but it improves their timing as well. So that really helped me. So again, I'm gonna take that E chord, and I'm just gonna go T, 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 like the drink T on the beat. So one, two, three, four. T, 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 and so on. For the quavers or the eighth notes, I'm picturing coffee. So I'm going coffee, coffee, coffee. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Then I'll have things like the semi-quavers or the 16th notes, they're my Coca-Colas. So I'm going 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, Coca-Cola, 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 Coca-Cola. And then there's things like Herters, which are not triplets. The Iron Maiden gallops are not triplets, they are something called herters, where they're still semi-quavers, but there's one quaver like thrown in for good measure. And that's like the da-da-da, 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 for example. That's what I call the Slayer, the da-da-da, 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 da-da-da. And I say lemonade, 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 lemonade. And then the Iron Maiden gallops become strawberry. Like strawberry, 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 strawberry. And it's little things like that that kind of help me break up, divide the beat, divide the bar into manageable chunks and just really hone in, especially on the kick and the snare. Then what I kind of do is almost reverse engineer it and go to a metronome and try it that way when I haven't got a really obvious one, two, three, four from the drums, and I kind of work on it that way. So I hope that helps. That's one of many tips I could give for the timing side of things, but you could try it with chords, single notes, whatever it is, whatever you're working on, and just really break up that beat and try it with a metronome and or a drum beat. So going back to the comments, I'm gonna have to scroll a little bit. So JRGTR, is that junior guitar? I don't know. So, hi Richard, what would you practice if you're stuck in a rut with improvisation? Weirdly enough, that helps me get on to my next point. So that's a very, very good question. About improvisation, but making it musical. And this is, for me, something I practice every day without fail. I will pick up a guitar, even if it's just for 30 seconds to a minute, and I'll improvise something on the guitar. I'll choose a scale that I'm familiar with, or sometimes not so familiar with, and I will just get familiar with that scale, kind of get the blueprints down, kind of walk through the steps, try the scale and go, okay, I can do this, this, this. And then I try and make my improvisation musical by combining the scale with the techniques, with the timing, and then the big bit for me is to leave space. And this is something that I found really, really interesting for improvisation. So I'm gonna do the good old A minor pentatonic scale again. So that's 5-8 on the low E, 5-7 on the A, 5-7 on the D, 5-7 on the G, 5-8 on the B, and 5-8 on the E. So. So now, it helps if you're playing to a backing track, again, to help with the timing, but I will improvise and I will just kind of, things that catch my ear, I'll leave a break and then I'll repeat it. It's the power of repetition with this. So for example, I'm just kind of do my own little thing. So. Same lick played twice. It's amazing how many people don't think to do that. It's weird. Guitarists tend to not do that, but it's amazing how many other musicians do that. So it's something we need to almost remind ourselves to do. I'll do that again. 1, 2, 3, 4. So now did you see what I did on that third one? Again, I'm just making this up off the top of my head. So I did this kind of thing, if I remember it. Same notes, slightly different rhythm. I allowed that space, and then it almost like a domino effect. I leave the space, and it's almost like if I'm going to use the same notes, I've got to cram in a little bit more to make it work out. So that's the kind of idea with it. So I'm not doing anything ridiculously fancy yet, but I can use the timing that I've been working on and just play around with that, flirt with that, leave the spaces in there. And one of my guitar teachers had a great way of doing this, and I pass this on to a lot of my students, especially if you're thinking rhythmically. We know the notes, and we know we can bend, we know we can slide, we know we can hammer on, pull off, all these good things. But a lot of people forget about the rhythm. So he told me to think like a saxophonist or think like a singer. Now, when you think what a saxophonist or a singer need to do, what's the thing they both need to do? They need to breathe. We're lucky, we can play guitar and breathe at the same time, so we are often prone to putting in a lot of notes, which is fun, don't get me wrong. We love throwing the notes in. But we need that space, otherwise people are going to switch off. And you've got to almost pretend, as weird as it sounds, pretend like you're playing to your grandma. Your grandma doesn't care if you can play a Steve Vai tune note for note perfect. She doesn't, well, at least my grandma doesn't know Steve Vai very well. But she was always really impressed when I could play something much simpler that she recognised. And you can almost force that in someone's head by repeating phrases and it becomes catchy and allowing the space where that breath would naturally occur. So I'll try a similar kind of thing, a different lick. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So do you see what I mean? Sometimes just repeating the same note with an interesting rhythm and then repeating that phrase really, really, really helps me. So it's just trying to make my improvisations more musical. And don't get me wrong, we love playing flash, but the space is really important. Another thing I try to do, and this helps me with even when I'm writing and trying to come up with strumming patterns or interesting rhythms, I actually will take someone's name or think of an object that's in the room, and I'll put them together. Like, my name is Richard Shaw. So, Richard Shaw, da da da. There's a rhythm. What can we have? Marshall amplifier. Da 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 da. So that's six. Marshall amplifier. Da 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 da. Da 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 da. So. So that was Marshall Amplifier, Richard Shaw. It sounds childish and almost laughable, but I find that really, really helps me. If I'm really stuck for improvisation tactics, I will literally take words and almost speak, even like get a book open and read maybe the first like half a page of something and try and follow, even if it's just run up in the scale, the kind of the natural cadence that my voice is saying when I'm reading out loud. Even now, I am improvising what I'm saying to you guys, and I bet if I transcribed this, obviously it's not note for note perfect, but I've got the rhythm. I bet if I transcribed this. Just little things like that, and I'm kind of building them like bricks in a wall. There's a little phrase. Next thing I know, I've kind of got this whole improvised solo under my belt. So I do hope that helps with that. I talked about that a little bit more than I was expecting to, but I hope all those little things can help you with your musicality and your improvisations. So let's go back to the comments. Great stuff, really enjoying this. Please keep this up. Oh, thank you, Hamza, appreciate that. Eric Walker, drum machine works good though. No, yeah, that's what I was saying. Like the drum machines, drum beats, metronomes, anything that gives you a beat, anything at all, like even playing along to records, which I'm gonna talk about next. Just everything will improve your timing. Play with a drummer, play with a bass player. Just something that's gonna give you some kind of beat, something to latch onto. So then you naturally improve your rhythm just from experience with playing with different instruments and playing with the metronome. So Gareth Morgan, is there a difference between your approach between heavy music and musical theatre? It's very different because musical theatre, 9 times out of 10, is sight reading. So getting to know your chords really, really well. Get a good chord vocabulary under your book, under your fingers, I should say. And then with metal, even though I have had to sight read on a couple of metal albums I've played on, it's not very sight read. It's more about the technique. So it's a different discipline, but just as enjoyable. So if I'm playing metal, I'm trying to make sure everything is as tight with the record as possible. Whereas musical theatre, it's a whole different discipline because I'm reading music and following a conductor. So it's very different, but the conductor is almost like our metronome, like we were talking before. So we've got a visual clue of where that tempo and timing is. So if we ever get lost, you look at the conductor, you know which beat you're on, you know what the tempo is. Little things like that. So yeah, so even though they're very different approaches, they have very strict disciplines at the same time. So yeah, there's all kinds of comments here. So, hi Rich, any tips for changing a bad habit that I've had for years? This is from Eddie Russell. Like trying to change to a better picking pattern when you found out you've been doing it wrong. That's a great question, Eddie. Because I often go through this where I've been playing something a certain way. I'll give you a bit of a backstory. I hope this story will help. For those who know, I'm a big Dream Theater fan, and it's just been my life goal to play like Petrucci and also have a beard like Petrucci, but neither of which are really going to happen anytime soon. So, one for genes and one just because he's superhuman guitar ability. So, I was trying to learn Dream Theater stuff as a kid, and I tried to get my picking like exactly the same, like even way held the pick, the angle, where his wrist was placed when he's palm muting, all these little things, all these little ingredients. I was studying what he was doing with live footage. And then a friend of mine could play like a Dream Theater solo that I was really struggling to play. But he had only been learning it like a few days and he could nail it, and I'd been trying it for a few months. And then I asked him and he just said, I don't know, I just do it the way that makes the most sense to me. And it was this big penny drop moment for me where it's like, I'm not going to be exactly like my hero. So what I do if I'm trying to get something and it feels super uncomfortable, I'll give it a while. Don't get me wrong. I will try it and I'll persist. But then there'll be moments where I'm like, maybe it'll make more sense to economy pick it here. Or maybe it'll make more sense to alternate pick it. Maybe I want to down pick two notes and then up pick the third one instead of alternate pick absolutely everything. So for me, that's more of a case of you play it the way that makes the most sense to you. Like I get really funny looks when I play the intro of Sweet Child of Mine hybrid picked, just because I find it easier to do. And that's how I got into hybrid picking, was almost like I was trying to do certain alternate picked things, like and string skipping things. And I suck at string skipping, but I can do it if I hybrid pick it. So it's little things like that. So I hope that helps where you try it your way. Try it the way it's meant to be, don't get me wrong. Try it, just try it a few different ways and you'll kind of settle on what works for you after a while. So I hope that helps. So how would you count a bar of 7-4 like stinging brought to my senses? So with 7-4 and odd time signatures in general, I basically try to split the bar. So for a lot of people, 7-4 can divide it into like 3 and 4 or 4 and 3, 2 and 5, 5 and 2. So it depends for me where almost like the heavy accent is within the bar. Like take something like Money, like. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Bom, ba, ba, bum, bom, 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 bom. I'm hearing that as a 3 than a 4. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4. So it depends where I personally feel the heavy accent is. You may feel it's in a slightly different place. But I find with any odd time signature, that really helps me if I can divide it. Like if it's something like 5, 8, for example. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Diddle, 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 diddle. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's that kind of thing. So that can be like a 3 and a 2 or a 2 and a 3. A 4 and a 1 sometimes. 9, 8, that's a similar thing. Do I hear it's like a 4 and a 5, a 7 and a 2. So I kind of divide it up to kind of just whatever it takes to kind of compartmentalize what that time signature is. So again, I hope that helps. I'll take a few more questions, then I'll go into my last point. Hello from Tempe, Arizona. Great shirt. Yes. What are the chances? So I played a venue in Tempe, Arizona, so the marquee with Cradle of Filth a few years back. And yeah, I got the t-shirt. So yeah, grinning ear to ear after that timing tip. I'll definitely add that tip to my practice. Great stuff. Thank you very much, Mark. I do appreciate that. So what I'll do is I'll get into my last tip. And for me, the biggest thing, there's two massive things that helped me in my guitar playing journey. Like obviously we've been talking about bending accuracy, left hand muting, timing, checking my notes here, and musicality from an improvisation point of view. But there's two main things, so I'm going to kind of put them into one, and that is playing along to records and playing with other people. Join a band, get playing with other people, even if it's just your friend down the road who plays a couple of chords, just get playing with them. If you have an actual band, get playing as often as you can, get out there, get gigging, get practicing, get rehearsing, get writing. Every time you're playing with other people and writing with other people, jamming with other people, you are learning something, even if you don't realize it. Like every single person, I owe my guitar playing journey to not just like some bands I've been in, and I've been very, very fortunate in my career and I'm exceptionally grateful. It's literally every single person who I know who has played an instrument. So for instance, if there's a violinist friend of mine and I've kind of picked their brain on something, I've played with them and I've not really thought of it that way. There might be another guitar player who plays literally the same riff I'm playing, but they're playing it with maybe a bit more vibe and go, okay, if I play with them, I can lock in a bit better. So to me, if you haven't got that luxury of playing with other people, like if you're in a small town with not many musicians, playing along to records, to me, is one of the most important things you can do. When you feel kind of ready to play with a record, do it. As soon as, pretty much every single one of my students, I'm like, we do not know how to play this song unless we can play it with a record. It's as simple as that. Even if we can only play one part of the song, let's nail it. Let's get the timing spot on. Let's lock in with those drums. And it's just a great feeling. I remember the day I could play Enter Sandman, for example. Even just the intro of Enter Sandman, and I was playing along with James Hetfield. It just spurred me on. And it's all about those little wins for me. And they are little wins in the whole scheme of things, but how many little things and little wins kind of build up in your guitar playing career? Infinite. Infinite. It's a daily thing. And that's stuff you can do for 1 minute. You hear a great riff on the radio, try and work it out by ear, try and play along with the song. That's a massive win, especially if you figured it out by ear. You'll be surprised. Again, coming back to listening, what these do wonders for you. So playing along with a record and playing along with other people is the biggest thing. So, and I know this is a 1 minute fix, so playing along with a record is a lot easier than trying to get a whole gig together. So, but even if you can just jam with somebody for 1 minute, you'll be surprised what you pick up, even if you think at the moment you're not really picking something up. Not to get too hippy trippy about it, but there's an exchange of energy and you will pick things up from that person. They will pick stuff up from you and you will improve. It's as simple as that. There's no doubt about it. No doubt about it. So I'll just go back to the comments for the last bit of this because we'll tie things up pretty soon. So from one Richard to another, this phrasing advice is fantastic. I just retired from teaching music for 27 years. Amazing. Wow. That's great stuff. So Steve Norwood, great tip regarding find your own best picking technique after experimenting. Look how Jeff Beck picked with no pick, just fingers. That's the thing, I just do it, it's almost gut instinct at this point for me where it's like, let me try it with just my fingers. Let me try a hybrid pick, economy pick, sweep picking, alternate picking, whatever it is. Am I going to down pick everything? Am I going to alternate pick everything? It obviously depends on the context, but it's amazing how many ideas have come up from just throwing the pick away. And I've gone, you know what? That's actually easy to play if I finger pick it. And I would never have thought that unless I actively sat down and almost explored my options. And that's how it works. The only thing with that is you just got to find a nice place to put it, that put the pick. So I put it here, which I've only ever seen one person do. Maybe I just don't know many people who do it. Maybe that's a very well-known thing, but I've only ever met one person who does that. That's literally between my... And so when I'm like playing like... it's stuck there and I find I can still use the fingers fine. I know some people do that, but obviously, you know... Plenty of room on this forehead just to stick it out of the way if I need it. I don't recommend putting it in your mouth because I know someone who's actually swallowed a pick, so don't do that. So, I'll go back to the comments. Can you play Evanescence for us? Not right now. But... like... For instance, going under just the big B5 power chord, preferably on a 7th string. Maybe we should do some more Evanescence for Licklibrary lessons. That'd be really cool. So, go back to these. So Rick Johnson, I've always struggled with the fast runs down a scale, not Steve Vai stuff, more like the 10-15 notes that you were doing in your intro piece. That stuff I always struggled with. And it's almost like we talked about improvising. Every time I improvise, I try and do something that I'm not 100% comfortable with, even on a live stream. I'm improvising. I want to surprise myself. If I fall flat on my face musically, so be it. Yeah, I'd rather take chances and give it a go. So that little like those kind of little things. I'll play that again. So, like the groups of six. But even things like that, it may look like I'm alternate picking everything, but I find it easier to pull off the first one. I don't know why. Again, picking things. As soon as I just pick the first note and pull off the second, I don't know why, but it frees up the rest of my hand to alternate pick every single other note after that. And I have no reason for it. It just feels more comfortable. So again, going back to that previous question of trying different picking things, all of a sudden I found I had a bit more speed and a bit more accuracy when I wasn't actually picking every single note. So I hope that helps you. So helmet strap. I've been playing along to records that I would not normally listen to, helping so much. Yeah, this is what I still do. I just pick, it's almost like sometimes I go, okay, I've been playing too much metal recently. Let's take a break from it and I'll play like, just pick a pop song that's maybe in the charts. Again, use my ear, try and work out what the chords are. I just like almost improvise over it because while I'm improvising, you've got the record in the background and the vocalist is doing something, you might steal some of those rhythms or even the melodies themselves if you feel confident enough to do so. And it's amazing how that becomes part of your repertoire as well. So I'm constantly mixing it up by just going, let me try this style today. Like, I haven't done reggae in a while. Let's solo over a Jimmy Cliff song or whatever it may be. So Ricky O'Devon, is that playing along with Argus from Front Page News was great for my guitar journey. Wishbone Ash, then Camel albums. Honestly, just everybody. In my experience, my best students are the ones who make a habit of no matter how simple the song, they play along with a record. Because it has this, again, domino effect that you don't realise how much your timing is improving, your musicality, your sense of rhythm, your kind of appreciation for what the other instruments are doing and how you fit in with that. You don't get that unless you play along to records or play with other people. Like, sat just playing by yourself to no backing tracks, nothing at all, for me is almost half the journey. So it was a big, big step in improving my guitar playing journey, especially. And we'll take this last comment here. So again, JRGTR. So such a great tip about playing to songs. Also just want to say, Richard, you helped me a lot with my guitar playing when you were teaching at universities. Ah, thank you very much. So yes, I was teaching at a couple of universities a few years back. So I was doing masterclasses at universities, but also actually a resident guitar lecturer at a couple of universities. So yeah. So thank you for that. I appreciate that. That's a nice way to end it. So thank you very much for joining me on this live stream. I do appreciate it. So those are my five kind of 1 minute tips about bending accuracy, left hand muting, just generally improving your timing, your musicality when you're improvising. And the big one for me, playing to records and or playing with other musicians. It's amazing what you can do. Even if it's just 1 minute a day working on those five things, you'll be surprised how your guitar playing will be elevated in a relatively short amount of time. And it's stuff I still work on to this day because these are the building blocks of what makes my guitar playing just sound better and sound like a professional. So thank you for joining me today. I really do appreciate it. Check out licklibrary.com for when the next live streams are gonna happen. Check out all the new courses. I've been filming 4 new songs today and a whole new course for rock and pop chord glossary as well. So check out the website, sign up if you haven't already, check out all of the stuff Lick Library has to offer. There are thousands upon thousands of lessons, song tutorials, techniques, improvising, timing, everything you can think of, Lick Library has it. So please, if you are able to, please sign up and you have access to everything on the site that they've ever produced, years and years and years worth of stuff, plus all the future stuff that will be on the website as well as all the backing tracks. I forget about the backing tracks. They're all on there as well. So please, if you haven't already done so, join licklibrary.com and sign up, and I will see you on future live streams. Thank you for joining me today. Take care.